فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. إن شاء الله تعالى, today we're going to start the explanation of the book At-Tibyaan. At-Tibyaan fi adab hamalة al-Qur'an, written by الإمام العلامة المجتهد محي الدين أبي زكريا يحيى بن شرف النووي رحمه الله تعالى. الإمام النووي رحمه الله, his biography مفصلا in details. I have previously once spoken about it. And I believe الإمام النووي's life is not one that deserves to be spoken in 5 to 10 minutes or 20 minutes. It deserves a whole day's lesson. But because we're really restricted with the time, and we won't, if we carry on going into his biography in details, we will not be able to cover the book. And the book is quite big, and we only have 3 days to finish it in. But Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala, his name is Muhyiddin Abi Zakariya Yahya ibn Sharafi ibn Murri ibn Hassan ibn Hussein ibn Muhammad ibn Jum'at ibn Hizam. Imam al-Nawawi is an alim, a great scholar from the scholars of Islam, and he was a Rabbani. He was one who nurtured the people upon the basic knowledge before he had spoken to them about any major knowledge. He was a godly scholar, as they say. He was a hafidh faqih. He reached a high level in hadith, and he reached a high level in fiqh. He was a shaykhul Islam of his time, and even after his time. And he was from the ulama who implemented the knowledge which they had. And he was truly grounded. He was ma'imat al-rasikhin. He was from the scholars who were grounded in their knowledge. And he was from the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was from the allies of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Nawawi was added to the list of the zuhad, the jurists. He was added to the list of the zuhad, the aesthetic ones, who were aesthetic, who left this world. Al-Imam al-Nawawi, with his knowledge and his wara', and wara' meaning staying away from the doubtful matters, it has not been found in anyone the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought it for him. His knowledge and his wara'. It was said that he used to live in Dimashq. And Dimashq was a place where people used to travel to because of the greenery that Dimashq offered and the fruits that Dimashq had. Al-Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala, he did not want to eat the fruits of the land Dimashq. فَكَانَ لَا يَأْكُلُ مِن فَوَاكِهِ Dimashq. He never used to eat from it, because the gardens and the fruits of Dimashq, for him there was a doubt in whether it was permissible the way that the people were trading it. The bay and the buying and the selling which the people used to do was a doubtful issue for him. So he left off in totality using what? Eating the fruit of the Dimashq. And that shows you what? Wara'. So his father used to send him food from outside Dimashq, and he used to wait for that food to arrive to him, and that's where he used to eat. It was said that as a young kid, Al-Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah, as a young kid, did not like playing with the kids. He would find a trouble when the kids would come and they would pull him and they want to take him to play. He wouldn't like the idea. He was amran bil ma'ruf, one who called to the good. ناهيًا عن المنكر. He used to prohibit the people from the evil. رحمه الله تعالى. The leader of his time, he prohibited him from so many things at his time. He went into his qala'ah, his palace, and he sat with him and he told him what he was doing was wrong. And the leader used to say, أَنَا لَا أَخَافُ إِلَّا مِنْ هَذَا النَّوَوِي. I don't fear anyone except this Nawawi, the leader used to say. So he was a person whose presence was felt. He was an individual, مُرَاقِبًا لِلَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. He used to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his private sittings and in his public sittings. رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى. Nawawi, رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ, one thing, شَهِدَ لَهُ الْأُمَّةِ, the Ummah have unanimously agreed for him on, is al-ikhlas wa iradatu wajhi Allah. How he was a sincere individual and he intended the face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We all know his book, Arba'een al-Nawawiyyah, is a book that studied and it sought right after a person memorizes the Quran. It's 40 hadiths. He brought them together, and now when you look at the people, they memorize it. It's rare that you go to a house except you find Arba'een al-Nawawiyyah there, whether in Arabic or in English or in French or in Dutch. You find that book. His other book, which is Riyadhus Salihin. Again, you rarely go to a house except you find this book. Whether the person is old or they're young, or they've just about heard Nawawi. And this, my beloved brothers and sisters, is a sign of ikhlas, sincerity. When a person is mukhlis and he does something, ibtigha'a wajhi Allah, he's seeking Allah's face subhanahu wa ta'ala, he does it for Allah alone, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala places qabool, acceptance on the face of this earth for him. Al-Imam al-Nawawi, he read and he memorized the kitab at-tanbih. And he memorized it in 4 months. He memorized also the muhaddab by Abu Ishaq al-Shirazi, which he explained himself in his Kitab al-Majmu', which is a sharh of the Kitab al-Muhaddab by Abu Ishaq al-Shirazi. And Imam al-Nawawi, each day he would study 12 subjects, daily. Daily, Nawawi, we used to do 12 subjects. This studying was sharhan wa tasheehan. He would basically correct his publication, okay, and the copy which he had. He would write explanation of the teacher on it, rahimahullah ta'ala. And he studied a lesson in Al-Wasit by Muhammad Al-Ghazali, and a dars in the Muhaddab of Ishaq al-Shirazi, Al-Jam' bayna al-Sahihayn, Asma'ur Rijal, Sahih Muslim, Al-Lum'a ibn Jinni, dars in Islah al-Mantiq by Ibn al-Sikkit, dars in Tasrif, Sarf, in Usul al-Fiqh. Sometimes it would be Al-Lum'a by Ishaq al-Shirazi, and it sometimes would be the Muntakab by Fakhriddin al-Razi. He took in Aqidah, he studied the Kitab al-Irshad by Imam al-Haramain. And look what he said about himself, 12 different technical subjects. And he said, وَكُنْتُ عَلِّقُ مَا يَتَعَلَّقُ بِذَلِكَ مِنَ الْفَوَائِدِ. Every benefit that came in that class, I would write a benefit in it. 12 subjects a day, regularly, non-stop. And I would write the benefit that would come from the teacher, I would write it. And today, if a teacher teaches more than one subject, or sorry, two subjects, more than two subjects, the students are complaining. They're complaining. Nawawi was so enthusiastic and so inspired that he said, one time I made my mind that I want to study medicine. So he embarked on that. He went out of his way to study medicine. And he said, I bought myself the Kitab al-Qanun by Ibn Sina. I bought it لِأَقْرَاهُ, so I can read it. And he said, when I read it, فَأَظْلَمَ عَلَيَّ قَلْبِي, this book, because it's filled with so much kufriya, disbelief. And he said, when I read it, it darkened my heart. وَبَقِيتُ أَيَّامًا, I remained days, لَا أَشْتَغِلُ بِشَيْءٍ, I could not busy myself with anything. It preoccupied my heart and my mind. So he said, I made the decision that it was this book that was bringing the darkness into my heart. So he said, I sold it straight away. Imagine those who take Harry Potter and read it and memorize it. What about those people who watch films, movies, okay? Those who spend their time doing those things and they want to be students of knowledge. Now you need to question yourself. You have to ask yourself a sincere question. Are you actually doing the path to seek knowledge? Now, oh, we just read one book which had all of this in it, and he felt that he, rahimahullah, could not be able to study. And Imam al-Nawawi took knowledge from the scholars and his people. He took knowledge from the people of his time. And he took from so many teachers. But from one of the most famous teachers which he took from is Al-Allama Jamaluddin Abu Abdullah Muhammad ibn Abdullah ibn Malik, the great grammarian. Ibn Malik was the teacher of Al-Imam al-Nawawi, the great scholar of grammar, whose Alfiyya we study. Alfiyya ibn Malik was the teacher of Al-Imam al-Nawawi. His students are so much in number. Again, we'll just take one. Alauddin ibn Attar, who actually wrote a thick biography of his teacher. Alauddin ibn Attar, who lazim al-Shaykh, he was really close with the Shaykh rahimahullah and took a lot of knowledge from him. Alauddin ibn Attar. And he'd actually written a whole biography of the author, rahimahullahu rahmatan wasi'ah. So I ask you students to go and to go and see the biography that was written regarding him. Alauddin ibn Attar said a story one time. He said Nawawi came to him, and Imam Nawawi came to him, and when Nawawi came to him, Nawawi wrote something. Alauddin al-Attar got hold of it, and he used to read it. So Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah said to Alauddin ibn Attar, I don't want you to give this, whatever you've gotten from me, my writings, you're not allowed to give it out. Keep it with you and destroy it after. Alauddin made a promise with Nawawi that he's going to destroy the works of, or that particular work of Nawawi. And he said it was very hard for me to do so because the benefits and the knowledge that was in that. But I took a covenant and an oath with him. So he said, I took it and I burnt it. So Nawawi and Alauddin ibn Attar, ibn Attar was very close to his teacher, so he actually wrote a biography for him. Nawawi wrote many books. He has many books that show his jalala, his position and his knowledge. He wrote Al-Rawdah, Rawdatu Talib. He wrote a book called Minhaj, which is sharah in Madhab al-Shafi'iyah. He has a book called Al-Majmu', which is a sharah of Al-Muhaddab Abu Ishaq al-Shirazi, and he died at Kitab al-Hajj. Sorry, he died at Kitab al-Bay'. Kitab al-Buyu', he died, he didn't carry on from there. He explained Sahih Muslim, and he has a kitab called Tahdhibu Asma'i wal-Lughat by Al-Azhari. He summarized it. He also has a sharh qit'ah, a portion of Sahih Bukhari. He has, rahimahullah. He has a book called At-Taqrib wa At-Taysir, which is the sharh that Jalaluddin al-Suyuti does on the kitab Tadrib al-Rawi. Tadrib al-Rawi by Suyuti is a sharh of At-Taqrib wa At-Taysir, written by An-Nawawi rahimahullahu ta'ala. He also wrote Riyad al-Salihin, Al-Arba'in al-Nawawiyyah, Al-Adhkar, Al-Manasik. He also even has a sharh on Al-Wasit, which he called At-Tanqih, rahimahullah. He also has a sharh on Sunan Abi Dawood. He has a book called Bustan al-Arifin. He has Al-Usul wal-Dawabit, Ru'us al-Masail, Al-Maqasid, Manar al-Huda. He has a book called At-Tarqis fil-Qiyam. He has Al-Manthurat. He also, even his student Ibn Attar, what he did, he compiled his teacher's fatawat. The fatawa of Nawawi is also published, and it's. He wrote a summary on Bayhaqi's kitab, Malaqib al-Shafi'i. He summarized it. And he took out all the chain of narration and he placed the book in a very summarized manner. He also authored this book that we're reading, which is At-Tibyaan fi Adabi Hamalat al-Quran. He has a book called Al-Adhkar, where he talks about the Prophet ﷺ is Adhkar. Nawawi rahimahullah was a very calm person, a very tranquil individual. He was a very calm, collective person, wasn't hasty. In his beard, there was little bits of white hair, they said, in it. And it wasn't whiteness that would come across as though it was age. And Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah, his name, it can be said as Nawawi, you can say, and you can also say as Nawawi. Both ways are correct. You can say it both ways. And it's a place where he, rahimahullah ta'ala, died in, which is Nawa, and that's where he's originally from anyways. He died there, next to his father, rahimahullahu rahmatan wasi'ah. And if I tell you the age that he died on, you'd be gobsmacked. He died at the age of 45. And Imam al-Nawawi was only 45 years of age when he died. And he's from the ulama al-uzzam al-ladhina atharu al-ilma al-zawaj. He gave precedence to knowledge over marriage. No, he never married. And he had no wives, nor did he have any children. He gave knowledge precedence over marriage. So inshallah ta'ala, without any further ado, we will carry on the kitab, as I said before. Nawawi's life, we spoke about it before. And this kitab that I already told you, which is written by Ibn Attar, who already spoke about Nawawi, you can go and read it from there, inshallah ta'ala. The author, rahimahullah, started by saying, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, wa bihi nasta'in, Rabbi yassir wa'ain. Now this is not something written by the author himself. Bismillah, in the name of Allah, the most merciful, the most gracious. وَبِهِ نَسْتَعِينُ وَأَنْ إِنَّ اللَّهُ We seek aid and help. رَبِّ يَسِرْ أَوَ اللَّهُ Make it easy for us. وَأَعِدْ And help us. This is, make easy for us and help us. This is from the editor of the book. Okay. قال الشيخ الإمام العالم الزاهد الضابط المتقن المحقق أبو زكريا يحيى بن شرف ابن مري النووي رحمه الله تعالى الحمد لله الكريم المنان ذي الطول والفضل والإحسان الذي هدانا للإيمان وفضل ديننا على سائر الأديان ومن علينا بإرساله إلينا أكرم خلقه عليه وأفضلهم لديه حبيبه وخليله وعبده ورسوله محمدا صلى الله عليه وسلم فمحى بي عبادة الأوثان وأكرمه صلى الله عليه وسلم بالقرآن المعجزة المستمرة على تعاقب الأزمان التي تحدى به الجن والإنس بأجمعهم وأفحب بها جميع أهل الزيغ والطغيان وجعله ربيعا لقلوب أهل البصائر والعرفان لا يخلق على كثرة التردد وتغاير الأحيان ويسره للذكر حتى استظهره صغار الولدان حتى استظهره صغار الولدان وضمن حفظه من تطرق التغيير إليه والحدثان وهو محفوظ بحمد الله وفضله ما اختلف الملوان ووفق للاعتناء بعلومه من اصطفاه من أهل الحذق والإتقان فجمعوا فيها من كل فن ما تنشرح له صدور أهل الإيقان أحمده على ذلك وغيره من نعمه التي لا تحصى خصوصا على نعمة الإيمان وأسأله المنة علي وعلى جميع أحبابي وسائر المسلمين بالرضوان وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له شهادة محصلة للغفران منقذة صاحبها من النيران موصلة له إلى سكن الجنان وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله الداعي إلى الإيمان صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وصحبه وشرف وكرم وعظم Or you can say, some of the nusakh say, وَعَظَّمَ مَا تَعَاقَبَ الْجَدِيدَانِ That's what it says, both copies, right? Say it. No.
The sheikh, the jurist, the knowledgeable imam, the pious, the aesthetic, the scrupulous, the proficient, Abu Zakariya Muhyiddin Yahya ibn Sharaf ibn Hizam and Nawi, may Allah have mercy on him, writes.
The author didn't say any of that. And he wouldn't say that about himself. To praise himself and to call himself Shaykh al-Imam al-Alim al-Zahid al-Dabid al-Mutqin al-Muhaqqiq. That's all written by, as I said, the editor said that. Now.
All praise is due to Allah, the most generous, the all-giving, the owner of bounty, virtue, and benevolence, the one who guided us to faith.
This is a virtue. It's min ni'am illahi that we need to praise him for. الَّذِي هَدَانَ لِلْإِيمَانِ That Allah guided us to Iman.
And gave our religion preference over other religions.
Islam is the best of all religions. Allah gave Islam that which He has not given any other religion. وَمَنْ يَبْتَغِ غَيْرَ الْإِسْلَامِ دِينًا فَلَنْ يُقُبَلَ مِنْهُ وَهُوَ فِي الْآخِرَةِ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ Then the religion which Allah accepts and the religion that is the greatest over all other religions is what? Al-Islam. Naam.
And further showered his blessings upon us by sending to us the most honorable and best of all his creation, his beloved, his cherished friend, his slave, his messenger Muhammad. May the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him.
Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Allah also, the extra additional blessing which he has bestowed upon us is what? That he has sent unto us Nabiullah Muhammad alayhi salatu, as a messenger, as a prophet. And Nabiullah Muhammad, as the author said, is Habibahu wa Khalilahu. He's Allah's Habib, and he's also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is what? He's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's Khalil. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Khalil means a very close friend.
A messenger, he used to eradicate the worship of idols and further honored him with the Quran.
So the Prophet's job was what? فَمَحَى بِهِ عِبَادَةَ الْأَوْثَانِ. Through the Prophet, Allah eradicated, he got rid of, he wiped shirk and idol worship. And Allah then honored the messenger further with what? بِالْقُرْآنِ. وَلِذَلِكَ the Salaf, they used to say, low and pathetic is a person who sees blessings in food and drinking. All he sees is blessing is al-ta'am wa sharab. Blessings are. The blessing is that a person realizes ni'matul Islam wal iman.
The perpetual miracle for every age and time.
The mu'jizah is mustamirra. The Quran, جَاءَ النَّبِيُّونَ بِالْآيَاتِ فَانْصَرَمَتْ وَجِئْتَنَا بِحَكِيمٍ غَيْرَ مُنْسَرِمِ آيَاتُ كُلَّمَا طَالَ الْمَدَى جُدَدُ يُبَيِّنُهُنَّ جَمَالُ الْعِتْقِ وَالْقِدَمِ. Every prophet came with a miracle. And every prophet's miracle died when that prophet died, right? Our prophet, on the other hand, his miracle carried on until he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, died. Sorry, until the day of judgment. This miracle does not stop. So we have it with us. فَأْتُوا بِعَشْرِ سُوَرٍ مِثْلِهِ. Come with 10 verses like it. Come even with one surah like it. If you're truthful in your claim.
Now. A miracle, he challenged all of mankind and the jinn to produce anything like, and by which he vanished and confuted those who chose to stray and transgress through its irrefutable arguments and clear evidences. Moreover, Allah has made the Qur'an the life of the hearts of those who have knowledge and understanding. Neither its repeated recitation nor the changing of the times causes its beauty or magnificence to fade. He has made its memorization so easy that even children have memorized it all.
And the Qur'an is from the miracles of the Qur'an that a person can actually read the Qur'an as a child and memorize it. This is from what? It's from the mu'jizat of the Qur'an. The repetition of reading the Qur'an also, it doesn't wear out the Qur'an. The more you read the Qur'an, the more it shines for you. كُلَّمَا طَالَ الْمَدَى جُدَدٌ يُبَيِّنُهُنَّ جَمَالُ الْعِتْقِ وَالْقِدِمِ. As time goes on, its gems and its jewels just increases and it grows. It even shines more, the Qur'an. Whereas, other things, when you read it once or twice, okay, that's it. It's finished. You don't really want to do it. You don't want to read a book more than twice, do you? Boring now. But the Quran, you read it every time something new comes out from it. The little children are made, it's made easy for them to memorize it. Hey?
And has guaranteed its preservation against change or distortion.
This Quran is protected. Inna nahnu nazzalna dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidhun. The Qur'an, Allah promised that He's going to protect it. There's no one on the face of this earth who can come and change the Qur'an. Allah is protecting it. As for the previous nations, they were told to protect their own religions. As Allah said in the Qur'an, بِمَسْتُحْفِظُوا مِنْ كِتَابِ اللَّهِ. You guys protect your own books. As for us, that's not the case. Allah has told us that He's going to protect the Qur'an for us. So the preservation of the Qur'an here does not only involve the wordings, also the meaning is protected. How does Allah protect the meaning? There are ulama that are always going to defend it. That anyone who tries to change the meaning, they're going to say that's not true. And they will debunk it. So the wording will be protected, and so will the meaning be protected.
No. And so it remains preserved by the grace of Allah and His favor for as long as the day and the night continue to alternate.
So the word al-malawan means day and night. The alternation, مختلف al-malawan, أي مختلف الليل والنهار.
He has chosen people of skill and proficiency to preserve its sciences, and it is they who have compiled within each of its arts that which bring joy and comfort to those who are firm in faith. I praise Him for these and others innumerable blessings.
The blessings of Allah are numerous. There's no amount that a person can put to it. وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَظَلُومٌ كَفَّارٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you this religion, has given you this Quran, and no one can come with the likes of it. So as an individual, this is a blessing. مِن نِعَمِهِ الَّتِي لَا تُحْصَى. From the blessings of Allah in which you can't put a figure to it. And it's numerous, it's hard, it's large in amount. No.
Not least of which is the blessings of faith.
That's the greatest of it. خُصُوصًا عَلَى نِعْمَةِ الْإِيمَانِ. That is the greatest blessing. If you lose everything, you lose money, you lose ownership. The blessing that a person realizes that there's no blessing above it is ni'matul iman, the blessing of iman.
And I ask him to bestow the blessing of his acceptance upon me, my loved ones, and every other Muslim. And I bear witness that there is no deity worthy of worship but Allah, alone without partner. A testimony that earns his beholder forgiveness, salvation from hell, and leads him to the dwellings of paradise. And I bear witness that Muhammad is his slave and his messenger, the caller to faith. May the peace and blessing of Allah be upon him, his family and his companions, and may Allah honor, extol and esteem him as long as the day and night alternate.
Then the author says, أما بعد فإن الله سبحانه وتعالى من على هذه الأمة زادها الله تعالى شرفا بالدين الذي ارتضاه دين الإسلام وإرساله إليها محمدا خير الأنام عليه منه أفضل الصلاة والبركات والسلام وأكرمها بكتابه أفضل الكلام وجمع فيه سبحانه وتعالى جميع ما تحتاج إليه من أخبار الأولين والآخرين والمواعظ والأمثال والآداب والضروب الأحكام والحجج القطعيات الظاهرات في الدلالة على وحدانيته وغير ذلك مما جاءت به رسله صلوات الله وسلامه عليه الدامغات لأهل الإلحاد الضلال الطغام وضعف الأجر في تلاوته وأمر بالاعتناء به والإعظام وملازمة الآداب معه وبذل الوسع في الاحترام وقد صنف في فضل تلاوته جماعة من الأماثل والأعلام كتبا معروفة عند أولي النهى والأحلام لكن ضعفت الهمم على حفظها بل على مطالعتها فصار لا ينتفع بها إلا أفراد من أولي الأفهام ورأيت أهل بلادنا دمشق حماها الله تعالى وصانها وسائر بلاد الإسلام مكثرين من الاعتناء بتلاوة القرآن العزيز تعلما وتعليما وعرضا ودراسة في جماعات وفرادا مجتهدين في ذلك بالليالي والأيام زادهم الله تعالى حرصا عليه وعلى جميع أنواع الطاعات مريدين وجه ذي الجلال والإكرام فدعاني ذلك إلى جمع مختصر في آداب حملته وأوصاف حفاظه وطلبته فقد أوجب الله سبحانه وتعالى النصيحة لكتابه ومن النصيحة له بيان آداب حملته وطلابه وإرشادهم إليها وتنبيههم عليها وأوثر فيه الاختصار وأحاذر التطويل والإكثار وأقتصر في كل باب على طرف من أطرافه وأرمز من كل ضرب من آدابه إلى بعض أصنافه فلذلك أذكر ما أذكره بحذف أسانيده وإن كانت أسانيده بحمد الله تعالى عندي من الحاضرة العتيدة فإن مقصودي التنبيه على أصل ذلك والإشارة بما ذكره إلى ما حذفته مما هنالك والسبب في إيثار اختصاره إيثاري حفظه وكثرة الانتفاع به وانتشاره ثم ما وقع من غريب الأسماء واللغات في الأبواب فأفرد بالشرح والضبط الوجيز الواضح على ترتيب وقوعه في باب في آخر الكتاب ليكمل الانتفاع صاحبه ويزول الشك عن طالبه ويندرج في ضمن ذلك وفي خلال الأبواب جمل من القواعد ونفائس من مهمات الفوائد وأبين الأحاديث الصحيحة والضعيفة مضافات إلى ما وراءها من الأئمة الأثبات وقد أذهل عن نادر من ذلك في بعض الحالات.
And to proceed, verily Allah the Most High has blessed this nation, may Allah the Most High increase it in honor, with the religion which He has both chosen for it and is pleased with, the religion of Islam, and has further honored it by sending to it the Prophet Muhammad, the best of all creatures. May the best of Allah's praise, blessings, and peace be upon him. He has also honored this nation with his book, the Quran, the best of all speech, within which he has placed all one requires of accounts of the first and the last generations, admonitions, parables, manners, a diversity of rulings, and clear and incontrovertible evidences that prove the oneness of Allah, the Almighty. All this comes in addition to what his previous messengers, peace and blessings of Allah be upon them, were sent with for the purpose of annihilating the arguments of atheists, the misguided, and those who transgressed. Allah has multiplied the reward of those who recite the Quran and has commanded us to engage ourselves with it, its study, recitation, and the practice of what it commands. Revere it, adhere to its manners it prescribes, and honor it in every possible way. Scholars of virtue have in the past and present authored books that are still known by learned men and those of understanding. With time, however, general motivation and enthusiasm to memorize and even to read such books has become so weak.
The author, rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions that the scholars have written books and he says, Ulul Nuha wal Ahlam. The word Nuha is Ahlul Uqul. People have brains. So the word Nuha, Wahiduha Nuhya, originally comes from the use of the word Al Nuhya, Bidhammin Nuni. Those people, smart ones, they wrote books. But as he says, ضعفت الهمم عن حفظها. The people's aspiration have become so low. They don't memorize those books. Let alone بل عن مطالعتها. Let alone them reading it. They don't memorize it. Neither do they even read it. So the aspirations of the people have died. Now he's saying it at what time? Then. Imagine if he was to say it today. He would have added on to what? They don't even know the book. They don't even know about the book.
That only a rare few of those gifted with intellect and firm understandings continue to benefit from them today.
The people who are smart, the author mentions that the people who will benefit from books and that will study and that will learn are who? Ulul afham, people of comprehension, people of understanding. Now everybody wants to benefit from books and not everybody wants to learn. If you truly go out of your way and you want to learn, then you have to know that this characteristics is a sign of what? That you're a gifted individual. Now,
upon noticing that the people of our land, Damascus, may Allah protect it as well as the rest of the Islamic land.
Ameen, we say today, look what's happening to Sham, the land which the author, rahimahullah, Dimashq, which he's talking about, and look what's taking place today. It's a sad reality. So we say, oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, bring back Sham to its people and get rid of the filthy regime of Bashar and his thugs. Get rid of them, Ya Rabbal Alameen, and bring it back to the hands of the Muslims. Oh Allah, you have the ability to do so. And Dimashq, brothers, was once the place where all prophets came from. The prophets of Banu Israel, all of them came out from Dimashq. Sorry, they came from Sham, sorry. They all came from Sham. And the ulama also came from this land. The Anbiya and the Rusul came from it, of Bani Israel, and also the ulama came from it. And as I said before once, the only place that our Prophet went to out of Jaziratul Arab, the Prophet only left Jaziratul Arab twice, sah? And where did he go? Sham, that's it. The Prophet's never been to any other place in the world, alayhi salatu wasalam. The only place he went to was Jaziratul Arab and Sham. And that shows you that they are the most, though they are the two greatest places in the world. Haramain, Mecca and Medina, and then comes Baytul Maqdis, which is in Sham. Naam.
We are showing increasing concern and involvement with the recitation of the Quran through either learning it and teaching it, or by expounding and studying it at both group and individual levels.
The author here mentions a concept which is reading the Quran and studying it together in groups, like we see a lot of Somalis do. They do subah, what's known as subah. Is that permissible? Yes, it's permissible. There's nothing wrong with it.
Striving hard in the vows by day and night, seeking the pleasure of Allah. May Allah increase them in their eagerness and concern for it, and any other act of worship they undertake. I was prompted to compile a book which summarizes the prescribed manners of those who carry the Quran.
The author here, no one told him to write this book. And as I said before, authorship of a book is done in two ways. The people come and they ask you and they tell you to write a book. And so you write the book based on the people's request. And sometimes the climate, the situation that you're in, demands from you to author a book. And so what you do is you author a book based on the demand. For example, a person sees that riba spreads in a land, and he sees that people are they're dealing with each other in riba highly. So what he does, he authors a book based on that. And now we hear, when he saw that the people were turning towards the recitation of the Quran, they were teaching the Quran, and etc. They were reading it individually and they were reading it in groups. He thought, okay, and they were striving day and night. He thought, okay, a book that talks about the manners and the etiquette of the one who's carrying the Quran should be authored. So this book was written. So he wrote this book.
Meaning those who have memorized it and the necessary qualities of those who concern themselves with this memorization and study. Indeed, Allah has made advice by means of calling to his book an obligatory task to be undertaken by his servants.
So the author is telling us here, the authoring of this book, he's doing it on number one, which was what? He was doing it because of the situation that he saw. People turning towards the Quran, the people learning the Quran, so he placed manners and etiquettes that they need to come with.